and he formed many, many generations of students of theology here in Indiana. I simply give him word so that his word is more important than mine, please.
Spoštovane gospe in gospodje, kot je še kolega Antoniran Špelič povedal, da smo v Sloveniji od leta 1980 pripravili dva prevoda svetega pisma. Najprej so na nek mensko izdajo, ki je šla 1996 in v 2007 zdaj pripravljalo Jerusalemsko, ki smo čisto na koncu. Tako sem lahko to predavanje zasnoval, tako da izhajam iz raznih tehnokritičnih vprašanj, ki zadevajo razmerje med jezikovnikom in najstarejšimi prevodi, med drugimi Vulgato. Dear ladies and gentlemen, as my colleague Miran Špelič mentioned already, we have prepared in 40 years two Slovenian complete translations of the Bible. First, the ecumenical translation of the Bible, which appeared in 1996, and since 2007, we are preparing the Jerusalem Bible, which is now at the end. So I could prepare this paper in the framework of the dilemma about the relationship between the original biblical languages and ancient translations, including Vulgate. This story of translation studies was marked by the first century commentator Cicero and then by the fourth century translator and commentator Jerome. This paper offers a historical examination and ideological critique of Jerome's views in the translation and interpretation of the Bible. It explores Jerome's complex relations to the Roman translation tradition on the one hand, and to an emerging Christian tradition on the other hand. It shows how Jerome in his translations prefaces to the individual works, commentaries and letters expresses his commitment to the distinct particularities of biblical language, style and message. In order to evaluate properly the development of Jerome's views on the translation and interpretation of the Bible, it seems important to consider the circumstances of his life and activity in many aspects. For the purpose of our study, the period of Jerome's translation of the Bible, the period 382 to 405, and the period of writing commentaries from 405 to 419 are especially important. Jerome was fluent in Latin and in Greek. He had known some Hebrew when he started his translation project from the time of his study in Syria, then moved to the Holy Land to pursue an elaborate study of the Hebrew language. He was regularly in contact with Jews and maintained several Jewish teachers. In 382, Jerome began his Bible translation by correcting the existing Latin language version of the New Testament, Vetus Latina. The preface of the four Gospels is of much critical value. He further began the collation of the various texts on the Septuagint and the other Greek versions of the Old Testament. In this period, he began to form the conviction that eventually led to his translation directly from Hebrew. An important segment of Jerome's vast literary legacy is his extensive collection of letters, epistolae, preserving 123 items, stylistically the best of his works. The first section, Jerome's views on translations in the prefaces to his translations. In the preface to the Chronicle of Eusebius, translated in the years 381-382, Jerome points to the difficulties arising from the various versions of the Old Testament. At the outset of his preface, he reports that our Tale literally translated whole books of Plato and describes the nature of the difficulties he encounters in his own translation endeavor. His words are, it is an arduous task to preserve felicity and grace unimpaired in the translation. Some word has forcibly expressed a given thought. I have no word of my own to convey the meaning, and while I am seeking to satisfy the sense, I may go a long way round and accomplish but a small distance of my journey. Then we must take into account the ins and outs of transposition, the variations in cases, the diversity of figures, and lastly, the peculiar and, so to speak, the native idiom of the language. A literal translation sounds absurd if, on the other hand, I am obliged to change either the order or the words themselves, I shall appear to have forsaken the duty of a translator. In this preface, Jerome already expresses his belief in the necessity of going back to the Hebrew original. Settling in Bethlehem 385, he succeeded in finding a number of Jewish teachers with whom he discussed diligently the properties of the Hebrew Bible. Jerome held the opinion that, as he says, the old flavor is not preserved in the Greek version by the 70, and illustrated the problem with the Latin translation of Greek poetry composed in hexameters and pentameters. As he said, when we read these in Greek, they have some meaning, when in Latin, they are utterly incoherent. But if anyone thinks that the grace of language does not suffer through translation, let him render Homer word for word into Latin. I will go further and say that if he will translate this author into the prose of his own language, the order of the words will seem ridiculous and the most eloquent of poets almost dumb. In the preface to the translation of Origen's two homilies in the Song of Songs, written in the year 383, Jerome claims, I have studied faithfulness rather than elegance. Between the years 383 and 385, Jerome made, at the request and under the sanction of Pope Damasus I, in Rome, a formal Latin edition of the New Testament. He revived the existing Latin version by the working with the Greek original. In the single remaining preface, that to the translation of the Gospel, from the year 383, Jerome addressed Pope Damasus thus. You urge me to revise the old Latin version, and, as it were, to sit in judgment on the copies of the scriptures which are now scattered throughout the whole world, and in that much so they differ from one another, you would have me decide which of them agree with the Greek original. If we are to pin our fate to the Latin text, it is for our opponents to tell us which. For there are almost as many forms of text as there are copies. If, on the other hand, we are to glean the truths from a comparison of many, why do not go back to the original Greek and correct the mistakes introduced by inaccurate translations and the blundering alterations of confident but ignorant critics? Jerome concludes, I have corrected only such passages that seemed to convey a different meaning. I have allowed the rest to remain as they are. This preface shows that for Jerome, the guiding principles was accuracy of translation in relation to the original, as he states, the true translation which had apostolic approval. By 388, 2 years after Jerome had settled at Bethlehem, he finished 3 works, the Book of Hebrew Names, the Book on the Sites and Names of Hebrew, the Book of Hebrew Questions. In preface to this, he mentions his preparatory studies for the translation of the Old Testament. His Old Testament transposition was not undertaken with ecclesiastical sanction, as was the case with the Gospels, but at the request of private friends and from his own sense of the necessity of the work. His translation work on the Old Testament was conducted in Bethlehem from 391 to 404. Jerome wrote prefaces to most translations of the Old Testament books. The first in order to publication was the preface of the Book of Samuel Kings. It was addressed to Paula and her daughter Eustochium and published around the year 391. Jerome presented this preface as an exposition of the principles adopted in all his translations from Hebrew. He writes, this preface to the scriptures may serve as a helmeted introduction to all the books which return from Hebrew into Latin, so that we may be assured that what is not found in our list must be placed amongst the apocryphal writings. The whole of the preface is dedicated to the nature of the Hebrew language and the structure of the Jewish canon of the Hebrew Bible. He emphasizes the originality of his approach of translating directly from the Hebrew original. He says, whatever by diligent translation and by anxious emendation we have learned and made our own is ours. And when you understand that whereof you were before ignorant, either if you are grateful, reckon me a translator, or if ungrateful, paraphraser, albeit I am not in the least conscious of having deviated from the Hebrew original. At all events, if you are incredulous, read the Greek and Latin manuscript and compare them with these poor efforts of mine. In the preface to the Book of Job, written in 392, and put into circulation about 393, Jerome defends his translation approaching this, the abuse of his opponents. He says, I am compelled at every step in my treatment of the books of the Holy Scripture to reply to the abuse of my opponents who charge me translation with being a censor of the 70, as though actually among the Greek authors and Symmachus and Theodosian had not rendered word for word or paraphrase or combined the two methods in a sort of translation, which is neither the one nor the other. In the continuation, Jerome shows the deplorable state of the Latin translation in many parts of Scripture and defends the accuracy of his translation approach. He said, the present translation follows no ancient translator, but will be found to reproduce now the text words, now the meaning, now both together for the original Hebrew, Arabic, and occasionally the Syriac. In the preface to the Book of Job, Jerome portrays the endeavor to learn Hebrew, having paid a considerable sum for the service of a Jewish teacher, as native leader who was among the Hebrews reckoned to be in the fourth rank, that the committee to translating only that which he had previously understood. He took seriously into consideration the nature of the text in prose and poetic form, which he compares with Greek and Latin poetry. In the preface to the Book of Job, Jerome explains also the aim of his commission to translate the Bible as thus to recover what is lost, to correct what is corrupt, and to disclose in pure and faithful language the mysteries of the Church. As he says, I have told to translate both the Greek and versions of the 70 and the Hebrew, which is the basis of my own, into Latin. Let everyone choose which he likes, and he will find out that what he objects to in me is the result of sound learning, not of malice. Second point, Jerome's views on translation his letter. Jerome's views on the commendable method of translating display conflicting theories and sometimes contradictions. In the year 696, Jerome wrote a long letter of Pamphilus on the best method of translating. This letter is his answer to severe criticism from some person who had brought charges against him, alleging that translating the letter of another man, he falsified the original and did not render the letter word for word. He defends his version of the letter by explaining the method of his translation work. So he explains it. I myself not only admit, but freely proclaim that in translating from Greek, except in the case of the Holy Scripture, wherein the order of the words is a mystery, I render sense for sense and not word for word. I have rendered them not as a translator, but as an orator, keeping the sense but altering the form by adapting both the metaphors and the words to suit our own idiom. I have not deemed it necessary to render word for word, but I have reproduced the general style and emphasis. In making it, I have utilized all the excellences of the originals, I mean the sentiments, the forms of expression, and the arrangement of the topics, while I have followed the actual wording only so far without offending our notions of taste. If all that I have written is not to be found in the Greek, I have at any rate striven to make it correspond with it. Horace too, an acute and learned writer, in his Art of Poetry, gives the same advice to the skilled translator. And cannot thou with over anxious thought to render word for word. The end of quotation. In letter 57.6, Jerome proclaims, in quoting my own writings, my only object has been to prove that from my youth up, I at least have always aimed rendering things, not words. My version always preserved the sense, although it does not invariably keep the words of the original. After citing passages from the Old Testament, quoted in the New Testament, Jerome concludes, from all these passages, it is clear that the apostles and evangelists, in translating the Old Testament scriptures, have sought to give the meaning rather than the words, and that they have not greatly cared to preserve forms or constructions, so long as they could make clear the subject to the understanding. In continuation, Jerome argues that in dealing with the scriptures, it is the sense we ought to look to and not the words. Jerome points to great additions and omissions the Septuagint has made in order to justify his preference to the original text. Nevertheless, he recognizes that the Septuagint has rightly kept its place in the churches, either because it is the first of all the versions in time, made before the coming of Christ, or else because it had been used by the apostles. But he is very critical to Aquila's approach in translating the Hebrew, which in the Greek, he said, on the other hand, we do rightly check Aquila, the proselyte and controversial translator who has striven to translate not words only, but their etymologies as well. Jerome concludes, how many are the phrases charming in Greek, which, if rendered word for word, do not sound well in Latin? And again, how many there are that are pleasing to us to Latin, but which, assuming the order of the words, do not alter with please Greek. In this letter, 106, Jerome defines as the task of a good translation to render idiomatic expression the one language beautiful structure peculiar to the other, and to represent the sense of the original rather than its wording. On the other hand, Jerome maintains that in the Holy Scriptures every word is important. In his letter 53, he claims, every name used in it, nay, even the conjunction of the words serves to show, throw light on narratives passed over in the books of Kings and upon questions suggested by the Gospel. 3. Jerome's shifting between culture worlds. Jerome's approach was not atomistic. Individual textual aspects operate in his translation independently as a unified system within a broader historic and literary context with a focus on exegetical tradition. Jerome's translation technique includes close comparison with the Hebrew text to isolate variations from Hebrew that fundamentally affect the sense of the text. In both translation commentaries, the twofold concept of sense overlaps, The fact that Jerome wrote commentaries after he completed the translation of the Old Testament shows a chronological development from the initial planar technique of translation to a later broad understanding of the concept of census, which includes stylistic elements of poetic and prose biblical text. A literal translation, a verbum de verbo tradition, which fails to reproduce stylistic devices of the original, would not actually be faithful. Jerome was well aware that scriptures includes metaphorical expressions and figures of speech. His broader understanding of census in rendering biblical texts led him to a situation of inconsistency between theory and practices, despite assumption his letter Palmatus, the translation requires the literal verbum ad verbum method. His rendition is most of the biblical books of the free translation. In conclusion, as a typical late antique figure moving between Jewish Christian and Christian cultural worlds, Jerome allows for a broader, more integrative approach to cultural systems as mediated through language. In our times, Jerome's figure signals a rethinking of the relationship between Judaism and Christianity and strongly inspired renewed interest in cross-cultural interchange. Jerome's influence grew throughout his life and increased after his death. His Latin Vulgate was the medium by which the cultural, religious, and social continuous transcended fundamental political and economic changes in the subsequent centuries. Before the 20th century, translation was an element of language learning. In the second half of the 20th century, the translation studies developed into an academic discipline. Translation studies is now a field which brings together approaches from white language and cultural studies. Thank you for your attention.